since the uprising against years of Assad rule began in 2011. Assad's forces have bombed hospitals and whole neighborhoods, claiming terrorists have taken over. When Russia's air force joined in after its intervention in Syria in 2015, it also justified airstrikes on Aleppo and other cities as a form of counterterrorism. Bashar al-Assad inherited this strategy more or less from his father, Hafez, who razed much of the city of Hama in 1982 to suppress a rebellion led at the time by the Muslim Brotherhood. This cruel ethos is echoed in a mantra that Syrian soldiers and pro-Assad militias have scrawled on buildings across the country over the past 8 years, from Aleppo to the rebel-held suburbs of Damascus. Assad will rebuild the country. First it was a threat, and now a sort of declaration of victory. How does the country rebuild after that? After its economy has cratered, and when its cities and towns are strewn with millions of tons of rubble, where the still rising death toll no longer makes the news, even though more than 500,000 people have died and more than 6 million have fled as refugees. Rebuilding Syria after nearly 8 years of war is estimated to cost some $388 billion, according to the latest estimate by the United Nations. It's a number that both seems strangely precise and also staggeringly large, and also keeps rising. But it won't happen, at least not yet. Even if and when it does, the regime's goal won't really be reconstructing the country that existed before the war. Instead, keen to declare victory on its terms, and at all costs, the Assad regime sees reconstruction already as a chance to consolidate what is left of Syria, and if it can, to cash in. It is hardly hiding this agenda. From Assad's recent speeches and statements, the way that formerly besieged rebel-held areas are presented as vanquished on state television, everything exalts in a kind of conquest. Amr al-Azim, a Syrian archaeologist from Damascus and a professor of history and anthropology at Shawnee State University here in the United States, described the regime's rhetoric to me this way. It is totally and utterly triumphalist. There's no disguising it, not even a fig leaf of an effort to try and somehow suggest post-conflict reconciliation, stabilization, unity, nothing. It is, we won. We won everything. These sentiments are all too clear in Aleppo. In late 2016, the government regained control of the eastern half of the city from various rebel groups after a sustained blitz by Syrian and Russian forces. Since then, there have actually been some token rebuilding projects with symbolic value, most of all at the Umayyad Mosque, also known as the Great Mosque, in the heart of Aleppo's old city. Its iconic minaret was toppled in 2012 by the regime's own artillery, according to most accounts. It is now being put back together by that same regime. But is this really reconstruction? Syrian novelist Nihad Saris doesn't think so. One of Syria's most prominent writers and a native of Aleppo who now lives in self-imposed exile in Berlin, he is an engineer by training. And as he told me recently, I don't think that to fix an arch somewhere in the little city or a minaret, it is not rebuilding. Yet this is why the work underway at the Umayyad Mosque is the story of Aleppo's reconstruction so far. It is shrouded in propaganda. Only the authorities in Damascus and their allies are involved, and it's hard to know what's actually been happening on the ground. Military engineers are running the restoration of the mosque, reportedly, rather than the Ministry of Culture, the Directorate General of Antiquities and Museums, or the Ministry of Religious Endowments, which otherwise administers the site. The main engineer in charge of managing the mosque's restoration told a Western journalist in Aleppo last year that, quote, "I have no idea why I was chosen for this project. Before this job, I built Aleppo Airport." Aleppo is also the story of Syria's wider reconstruction and all of its ambiguities. The Assad regime is prioritizing what to rebuild and what not to. It will restore symbolic sites that are considered useful for propaganda, but neglect the devastated stretches of the city that supported the opposition and were once home to most of the refugees that have since been driven from Syria. The regime has two possible areas of interest in reconstruction, Amr al-Azim told me. One is a means to reward those areas and individuals that were loyal to it. Two, for the regime's coterie to enrich itself. Any post-war reconstruction situation has contingencies, of course, but in addition to what the regime really wants, there's ambiguity in Syria on a more practical and even technical level. Does anyone agree on what reconstruction means in Syria and what it should entail? In addition to imposing sanctions on the Syrian regime, for years now, the United States and most European governments say they won't help fund any major reconstruction in the country as long as Assad remains entrenched in power. But he The official position of the United Nations is that it won't support physical reconstruction in Syria until there is a viable political transition underway. But the war hasn't ended. Political talks to resolve the fighting have been dragging on in various forms since the conflict began. There have been four rounds of talks in Geneva, all of them unsuccessful. Since 2016, following Russia's intervention, talks moved to Astana in Kazakhstan and then to Sochi. But Assad didn't survive after all of these years, destroying so much of Syria in the process, to step aside and negotiate settlement. The question that always comes up is, well, what is reconstruction? An advisor at the United Nations Development Program in Syria told me recently. As he said, it has never been defined, which is good and bad, and has allowed everybody to kind of move. When the UNDP talks about reconstruction, as he explained, quote, we're really talking normally about significant multi-year programs that look at the rehabilitation and or construction of significant infrastructure in a particular country. And that's not what we're involved in Syria, and frankly, nobody is at this point. It just requires funding sources that are not available right now. Despite the lack of definition and the lack of money, the UN is still actively involved in Syria, including in projects that might otherwise sound a lot like efforts to rebuild. We don't do reconstruction. No one does reconstruction in Syria, as the same UN official described the current situation. Yet the UNDP does fund smaller projects, all classified as humanitarian assistance, and described by the UN as rehabilitation, recovery, and community resilience in 9 of Syria's 14 governments. That means local-level assistance to restore basic essential services like sewage networks, water lines, or electricity, as well as schools, as well as repairing schools and hospitals. Through the first half of 2018, for example, the UNDP says that this work, at a total cost of about $41 million, $8.5 million in Aleppo, directly benefited nearly 50,000 Syrians, and indirectly benefited 2 million more. It's important and life-saving work, but it only represents about 0.01% of the overall reconstruction needs in Syria, based on that $388 billion figure. There is another ambiguity. There are strict protocols to distinguish this kind of activity from what the UN otherwise considers to be formal reconstruction. And a grim calculus determines what the UNDP and other UN agencies can and cannot do. Take a school in eastern Aleppo, for example. Based on what is categorized as, quote, rehabilitation, as opposed to reconstruction, the UNDP and UNICEF can repair a school whose structure is only partially damaged. But it cannot help repair a school that has been destroyed down to its foundation, since that crosses the threshold into what is considered formal reconstruction. Another UNDP official who's based in Damascus and works in Aleppo told me that the red line is 30 to 40% of the initial level. So if damage goes beyond 30 to maximum 40% of the initial volume of the building, then we consider it reconstruction, and we don't intervene. The same UNDP official recalled having to turn down a request from a neighborhood committee in one eastern Aleppo neighborhood whose school was, quote, more or less too destroyed to be rebuilt, even though he and his colleagues had the resources to help them. He said that he wasn't alone in wishing that this policy were different, and told me that there should be a clear distinction between reconstructing something that will benefit the war economy, that would benefit the regime, and rehabilitating a service that would be essential to providing a minimum assistance to people, such as the school. Rebuilding more schools, he added, would also help avoid what he called the potential perfect ground for another future ISIS to arise. UNICEF estimates that there have been more than 4,000 attacks on schools throughout the civil war, and currently there are some 1.5 million students, if not more, who don't have a school to go to. To someone in eastern Aleppo, these questions of who can or will fund what, and the more immediate distinction between what the UN defines as rehabilitation rather than reconstruction, it may determine whether or not a school gets rebuilt, or if a health center or hospital can even be rebuilt. And in such an uncertain situation, many people are left to take matters into their own hands. Over the past year, some life has returned to once desolate areas in eastern Aleppo, as more refugees have returned. The signs of reconstruction, though, are mainly evident in small shops selling cement, iron, and other construction materials. These are resources, quote, not for big companies, but for people, the same UNDP official explained. It's someone, he said, who was buying 2 or 3 bags of cement to rebuild the wall of his house. Syrians essentially are left to fend for themselves. To put this in context, although the fighting has ended, most of eastern Aleppo still looks like no man's land. Much of its urban landscape has been reduced to piles of concrete and rebar among the tens of thousands of homes destroyed or damaged in the battle over the city, according to satellite imagery analysis by the United Nations. On a visit to the city last year, the UNDP official in Damascus I spoke with remembered driving for kilometers through eastern Aleppo neighborhoods, like Al-Hanano and Al-Shar, where he only saw two things, destruction and looting. Even the frames from the windows have been stolen, he said, and there's no sign whatsoever of investment in reconstruction. The Syrian government, not surprisingly, has a different view of the city. A regime well-versed in propaganda, it has recently found new outlets online. Syria's Ministry of Tourism, for example, has a surprisingly active YouTube account, given the state of affairs in the country. In quick promotional videos, many no more than a minute long, it shares snapshots of Syria that are meant to remind viewers of scenes of better days, or to distract from the current reality. Increasingly, though, it has also been looking ahead. A video uploaded to its account last November presented an optimistic view of Aleppo, quote, between history and the future. This is a still from one of those videos. There is no hint of the scale of urban warfare that had consumed Aleppo, from street to street combat and explosives that were tunneled under parts of the old city by Islamist rebels, to so many barrel bombs and later airstrikes by Syrian and Russian forces, all designed to maximize civilian punishment. Instead, the video opens with the sun rising over a serene Aleppo skyline. It quickly cuts to an aerial shot of the citadel you see here, the massive medieval limestone fortress built over a steep tell or hill that lords over the city. In the battle for Aleppo, this medieval military site became a modern military target, as Syrian soldiers set up positions high atop the citadel to fire on rebels below. The battle may be over, but the citadel today has the damage to show for it, with pockmarked parapets and walls that have been battered by heavy artillery. In the tourism ministry's video, though, you can't see much of this damage from the drone footage on high, but you can make out a giant banner of a beaming Bashar al-Assad draped over a section of the citadel's wall. The citadel's stout, imposing entrance, built to repel crusaders, is also draped in an enormous Assad banner and Syrian flags. Drone footage in the ministry's video then pans over the streets of central Aleppo below, where excavators and trucks move piles of rubble, and where workers and vests stand on scaffolding that surrounds an Ottoman-era clock tower, another city landmark and bright spot among all the debris. Then the camera passes over a huge crane standing at the Umayyad Mosque. UNESCO considers the mosque to be one of the architectural masterpieces of the Muslim world. The crane is roughly standing where the mosque's 1,000-year-old minaret once stood, in its northwest corner. Built when Aleppo was ruled by a dynasty of Seljuk Turks, the square minaret was adorned with Kufic inscriptions and intricate carvings. Since Aleppo's old city had more or less retained its medieval-era skyline for centuries, the 150-foot minaret had dominated views around it for more than 900 years. It collapsed on April 24th, 2013. The Assad regime said, quote, terrorists blew it up. The rebels blamed the regime. Months earlier, though, the minaret had been damaged by shelling fired from the citadel, the direction of regime forces. An entire city was being destroyed around it, with all the accompanying suffering. But the ancient minaret seemed to capture the war's toll, as architectural symbols and cultural heritage often do, at least in news reports. That same month also, in April 2013, another ancient minaret was destroyed in Syria, one that was even older than the Umayyad mosques. It was the Omri Mosque in Deraa, in southern Syria, where the first protests against Assad began. The Omri Mosque is one of the oldest in Islamic history, originally built in the 7th century. It, too, was destroyed during fighting between rebels and government forces, targeted local activists there said by government tanks that were intent on destroying the symbol of the opposition. That's because the Omri Mosque had served as a field hospital and shelter for protesters in the early days of the protests in 2011. By shelling its minaret, the regime had, in the words of the local coordination committee, an activist network in Deraa, not only destroyed stones, but also destroyed religious and historic heritage that is a source of pride for the people of Syria. In the tourism ministry's video, the Umayyad Mosque's collapsed minaret is no longer reduced to a pile of limestone spilling out into the courtyard, as it had for several years. You can see that workers have instead collected those stones into neat piles. Some catalog them, and others are shown cutting and stacking new ones. The minaret and the rest of the Umayyad Mosque are being rebuilt, it seems, and the work is being paid for by one of Aleppo's newest patrons, Ramzan Kadyrov, the the strongman of Chechnya and one of Vladimir Putin's proteges. In 2017, I take a quasi-charity that is named after Kadyrov's father, a former Chechen rebel turned Putin ally, announced by a Russian state news agency that it had donated $14 million to reconstruct the Alliance. It was also funding the reconstruction of the badly damaged late Ottoman era Khalid ibn al-Walid mosque in the ruins of Homs. The Russian state media story that trumpeted Kadyrov's donation to Aleppo quoted the mufti of the city, its highest religious authority, who stuck to the regime line that the destruction of the Umayyad mosque was, quote, all done by militants and terrorists. Ramzan Kadyrov, mufti said, had vowed to fully restore the building, even if more money would be needed. In promoting Kadyrov and his charity, official Russian media added a pointed message about who it claimed was helping to rebuild Aleppo and who isn't. No other international foundation or organization, including UNESCO, it claimed, has so far offered any assistance. But other Syrians had, in fact, helped protect the Great Mosque any way they could during the worst days of the war. Dodging sniper's bullets, young Syrian activists, many of them architects and archaeologists in training from Aleppo University, had built a barrier of bricks to shield the mosque's decoratively titled Tomb of Zechariah, where worshippers prayed to the father of John the Baptist. Others constructed a protective padlock case around the 14th century sundial in the mosque's large marble courtyard with sandbags and masonry. The secured sundial was even still standing there last year, as Diana Dark, a British writer, noted on a trip that she made to Aleppo having snuck on a government tour. Its seals were still intact, she reported, somehow overlooked by engineers and propagandists, a small and solitary but defiant reminder of who protected what in this war. Syrian military engineers remain at work in the Umayyad Mosque, rather than experts in Islamic architecture. The UNDP official in Damascus confirmed that these engineers had made a detailed inventory of every stone that was on the ground and compared it with photographs of the minaret before the war, in order to try to rebuild it. But the real work, he added, hasn't started, and the Syrian military is directing everything. Before the war, the area around the Umayyad Mosque, the center of Aleppo's old city, was famous for its well-preserved medieval urban fabric, as we've heard this morning. Today, though, the scale of destruction around the mosque is the worst in the old city. UNESCO estimates that 60% of the old city's buildings were severely damaged in the war, and 30% completely destroyed. That's why, as that same UNDP official added to me, this reconstruction of the mosque and the minaret, although it's symbolic, at the end of the day is paradoxical, because nobody lives around there. If reconstruction is the next stage of Syria's war, it will unfold like the others, as a grinding stalemate. Emboldened by its near victory at all costs, Assad's government insists that it will only award contracts for reconstruction to, quote, friendly countries. We welcome any assistance with reconstruction from those countries that were not part of the aggression on Syria, its foreign minister told the UN General Assembly last year. The countries that offer only conditional assistance, he added, or continue to support terrorism, they are neither invited nor welcome to help. The regime's goals are already evident where it has reestablished control. Last year it passed a controversial measure known simply as Law 10, we've also heard about in more detail, to seize abandoned properties and redevelop the devastated land in the name of reconstruction. Critics allege that it is a way to make the war's demographic shifts permanent, while enriching Assad's cronies, since the areas that it targets were poor, informally developed, and largely assumed majority before the war, like the neighborhoods of eastern Aleppo. Developments involving businessmen tied to the regime are already underway. The most prominent, called Marotta City, promises glittering high-rises over expropriated and raised land in a Damascus suburb. It is currently said to be Syria's largest investment project. But most of the world is still withholding money. Especially in Washington, policymakers argue that aid money for Syria, even for humanitarian purposes for what is generally called stabilization, which might cover the kind of recovery work that the UNDP does, as well as things like removing landmines in territory formerly held by ISIS, could inadvertently go to supporting the war economy or Assad's own interests. Government forces in Syria have also shown a long track record of blocking aid convoys and even seizing them outright. And many fear that funds for reconstruction or rehabilitation or recovery, depending on the definition, could also be co-opted. Earlier this year, the European Union expanded its sanctions against financial supporters of the regime to cover 11 additional Syrian businessmen and 5 companies. One of them, Samir Fawz, has pitched himself as the middleman for Reconstruction and is behind that Morocco City project in Damascus. He got rich throughout the war, as many businessmen fled. He sold everything from wheat to cement and owns a steel plant in Homs, Syria's third largest city, where new rebar is apparently now being forged from melted down scrap metal and the ruins of the city. In a rare interview with the Wall Street Journal last year, Fawz said that he said that European countries should work with him to help rebuild Syria, in his words, to draw refugees back. According to that interview, Fawz wants the furnaces of his home steel plant to be a cornerstone of Syrian reconstruction, even before a political settlement. The biggest obstacle to any reconstruction in Syria, though, and why any effort that isn't strictly humanitarian aid won't really happen for now, is sanctions. How to get the money out. International funds for Syria must go through its central bank, which is exactly what sanctions are designed to block. Otherwise, the regime gets much-needed hard currency. The regime knows it, Amr Bassam said, which explains its current thinking about reconstruction, and why, in his words, it insists that any work, any reconstruction, any activity has to be done through it or its own agencies. That way, it gets its hands on the hard currency, but more importantly, it claims legitimacy. By broadcasting Shuri propaganda about the supposedly busy pace of rebuilding underway in Aleppo, while most of the city, in fact, is still in ruins and neglected, Syria's Ministry of Tourism is doing its own part. Whenever the minaret in Aleppo is rebuilt, Aleppo may end up looking a lot like Homs in more ways than one. Syrian rebels proclaimed Homs the capital of the revolution in the early days of the uprising. It then became the regime's model for how it would prevail in the civil war. Homs was besieged, bombarded, and its residents starved into surrender. Nearly two-thirds of the city has since been razed. As one architect from Homs said, "We basically don't have a cityscape anymore." The city's main landmark here is the Khalid ibn al-Walid Mosque, which was built in the waning years of the Ottoman Empire in the early 20th century in a typical Ottoman style. The mosque was on the front lines of the war's earliest fighting. The besieged neighborhood around it was largely destroyed by the time rebels evacuated the city by 2013. Homs, like Aleppo, has been left largely in ruins, with a few exceptions. The mosque, with Chechen funding from Kadyrov, has been hastily rebuilt. Its signature domes, once riddled with huge holes, reconstructed by military engineers, just like in Aleppo. A Western reporter who toured Homs in April 2018 noted that the government was, quote, keen to show off the mosque's restoration. Indeed, the Ministry of Tourism features it in another one of its YouTube videos, another still here, with aerial footage of the mosque standing desolate in a ghostly city over a triumphant soundtrack. As one man in Homs told that Western reporter last year, there is no one here to pray. The limited rebuilding efforts in Homs have otherwise been confined to the city's Christian neighborhoods, to buttress Assad's claim of protecting Syria's minorities, including the Alawite sect, to which he belongs. The flattened former rebel districts, including largely Sunni, have been largely ignored and left empty. It's hard not to see those stretches of the city, in Homs and in Aleppo, emptied of people, as the embodiment of what Assad said was, quote, one in the world, a society without any of his opponents. Areas of Aleppo could fit Assad's vision of victory. Some 450,000 people have returned to the city since early 2011, but Aleppo was completely paralyzed in relation to any kind of formal reconstruction, according to that UNDP official I spoke with in Damascus. There is said to be a vague government master plan for the city's reconstruction or restoration, but like most things in Syria, it's a black box. Instead of planning, there is only propaganda, like the banners around the city that show Assad's face hovering over an image of the citadel and proclaim Aleppo in our eyes. Despite all the stasis around reconstruction, and the frozen political dialogue, and all the unknowns about how the civil war might perhaps finally end, the UNDP and other humanitarian organizations still have a mission in Syria, providing assistance to Syria's diminished population of 17 million people. 8 years of sanctions haven't forced Assad to reform, to stop laying siege to rebel areas, or release thousands of prisoners. What is left of Syria's economy today is more dependent than ever on Iran and Russia. But even if foreign money could flow in, how would the regime spend it? Again, Aleppo and Homs offer some clues. As Amr al-Azim put it, the areas that have been most damaged, that most need reconstruction, the areas that were bombed by the regime and produce the refugees in the first place. The regime is not about to go and take all that money and rebuild their homes. It's going to take the money and reward the areas that are loyal to it. If the authorities in Damascus don't actually foresee a full-fledged reconstruction process, how much leverage over Assad do Western governments really have with sanctions? In the regime's rhetoric, everything is post-crisis, not post-war. And the promise of huge amounts of money from the West to rebuild may not appeal if rebuilding all of Syria isn't really the regime's goal. Assad has other priorities, consolidating control of territory and ensuring the support of its allies. If anything, Russia may be more interested in the benefits of reconstruction in order to add to the optics of its intervention and claim that it, not the United States, is stabilizing Syria. Then it could justify taking more of its forces out. The patronage from a close ally of Vladimir Putin to pay for the hasty restoration of two mosques in Aleppo and Homs fits right in. Even the minaret has a political background, novelist Nihad Siri's Twitter, of the work at the Umayyad Mosque, pointing to its soft power potential. The Russians, he said, they want to tell the Syrian people, look, we respect Islam and Islamic heritage. For Ramzan Kadyrov in Chechnya, Islamic charity has its own purposes at home for propaganda, too. The Chechen government, Siri said, participates because they want to tell their people that they care about Islam and about Islamic heritage. But where does that leave Syria? Nihad Saris knows this regime, not least because his home city of Aleppo was also part of that earlier uprising against Hafez al-Assad in the 1980s and was punished for it, but not as badly as the city of Homs. Saris knows the regime hasn't changed, though, and he doesn't think neighborhoods like those in eastern Aleppo will actually be rebuilt. The regime, he said, is so corrupted and is so surrounded with corrupted people. He said of the prospects as well for reconstruction contracts. Rebuilding is like a golden egg, in his words. Everyone sits and is waiting to get it, or to get a good part of it. Saris ran his own engineering office in Aleppo before he turned to writing. Rebuilding is now theories, plans, papers, and charts, he said. No one knows when they will actually start. The Assad regime, though, would like the world to think otherwise. It has been declaring Syria ready to be rebuilt, in fact, for years, hosting so-called reconstruction fairs on the outskirts of Damascus, even as the war raged around them. A former rebel stronghold lies in ruins nearby, and the wrecked building and wrecked buildings line the highway, running from the fairground where these conferences had been held to the center of Damascus. 2 years ago, a mortar attack on one of these reconstruction fairs reportedly killed 6 people. But the regime has remained unnecessary. When he opened the latest reconstruction fair last fall, Syria's Minister of Housing and Public Works proclaimed that, quote, the process of eradicating terrorism has reached its final stages, and the reconstruction phase is knocking.